Well, I greet you in the blessed Holy Ghost. I'm Brother Dwayne, and we welcome you to another exciting episode of the Cry for America. We are brought to you by the Shekinah Family Worship Center, where Pastor Fields is our leader. We can be reached on the phone at area code 313-300-6457, or find us online under the Cry for America. We're on YouTube, Rumble, Facebook, and the Podbean Podcast. Please subscribe to our channel. Leave a like, a comment, a thumbs up. Share it on your platform and help us to let this word of God go forth as we are documenting God's servant, Apostle Kwaw, as he is ministering here this Good Friday, April 7th of 2023, the Easter Conference in Detroit, ministering on the healing love of God. Let's go now to Apostle Kwaw as he is ministering on the death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ.
In the name of Jesus Christ, our Father is healing.
I thank God for His mercy.
Yes.
I thank God for everyone online.
Thank you, Jesus.
My prayer for all of us is that if we ever listened, we will listen tonight,
Amen.
Tomorrow night, and Sunday. If we ever listen to the word of God, we listen tonight, and listen tomorrow, and listen on Sunday. It might be the time that you are touched deeply by the Spirit of God through the word of God. So my desire for you is that you open your heart. Open your heart. Open your heart. Open your heart.
Amen.
This is the night that you can receive something.
Thank you, Lord.
This is the night that you understand that you don't have to be a captive of sin, of sickness, and of death.
Amen.
You didn't hear what I said? I said it might be this weekend that you would understand deeply that you don't have to be a captive of sin, a captive of sickness, and a captive of death.
Amen.
I want to say one more time.
Amen.
Because I ain't hearing no Amina online. I said, I ain't hearing no Amina online. Anyway, by the way, let me send you, Pastor Charles, greetings to all of you. He hooked me up to his church, and I preach a little bit in French.
Amen.
They still remember that I came back there.
Amen.
My brother was gone. So I told them they should be ready because we are coming there. Who will storm Togo.
Amen.
So they are anticipating. They are ready, and they're going to, they may call in tonight because Pastor Charles said we are all night prayer.
Amen.
We
he's
pray.
Actually on right now.
Oh, he's on?
Yeah, he's online.
Yeah, where's the Amina, man? You went down your job? If you're online, you went down your job. Amina, oh yeah, he there. Yeah, that's him. You got some stuff with some people with you too, they will say Amina. Or you are by yourself.
Yeah, Amina.
Alright.
Losing his voice already.
I said this is the weekend that you may have a breakthrough in your understanding. That you no longer have to be. I know it's been said over and over. But you no longer have to be a captive of sin, of sickness, and of death.
Amen.
The seed of these three is sin. You sin, the child of sin is sickness, and the child of sickness is death. The three always go together. And these are the three that have been, you know, destroying lives.
Amen.
They have destroyed the lives of multitude of God's children. Even in the house of God.
Amen.
You don't seem to have victory over sin, victory over sickness, victory over death. Ain't that something? But I pray that tonight, tomorrow, and then Sunday, you will understand. Okay? You will get a deeper understanding, and you will be free from the torment, right, of sin, sickness, and death.
Amen.
The first one to enter into the human soul was sin.
Amen.
And because he lost the divine protection, now the people are called James. You know James? G-E-R-M-S. Germs. I call them James. James entered in. Germs. There was nothing to protect man. Divinely speaking. Because God did not create man for him to be sick. He didn't create man for him to die. Wake up. It is time for the people of God to understand their inheritance.
Amen.
Sin free, sickness free, death free.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
You said death free. Yeah, death free. Because death ain't got no more power over any child of God who understands. Because death now becomes, you know, a pathway for you to glory.
Amen.
That's it. It does no longer hold any power over every child of God.
Amen.
And enslaves you and drag you into the pit of destruction.
That's right.
It's time for us to understand the word of God.
Amen.
And not just play games.
Yes.
Ministers are playing games with the word of God.
Amen.
And believers are following them playing games with the word of God.
Amen.
You owe it to God to be free from sin.
Yes.
You owe it to God to be free from sickness and infirmities.
Amen.
You owe it to your God to be free from the power of death. Oh, death, where is thy power? You owe it to God to live free from these demonic forces.
That's right. Amen.
Anybody understanding me?
Amen. That's clear.
I say, anybody understanding me online? I need some Amina. I love you. I have been burdened, but it seems like I don't have no brother. I don't know what is happening to me. It seems like, I don't know, just like nonchalant attitude. But that's the time that the Holy Ghost is dangerous in me. When it seems like, I don't know no more now. I'm just going around peacefully.
Yeah.
Woo! Jesus.
Amen.
He lives.
That's right.
I want us to sing the first song. Right? The love of God. Okay? The love of God. And when we sang the first song, it says here, when the race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me. Yet not I. But the problem is, are you running the race?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
Amen.
How are you going to say, when the race is complete, when you ain't running it? All you do is just go to church, sing in the choir, and do your own thing. There's a race to run. You better get involved in it and run it.
Right.
Till the end.
Amen.
And then you can say, when the race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me, I got the victory. through Christ in me, I ended the race. I crossed the line to the finishing line. All right. You have the song, Pastor. You have, Pastor Bradwin, you have the song, The Love of God. You didn't tune it out for me? Okay. You have it? Okay. See, I forgot I got to set this guy up. See, I just get loose and I'm going. Thank you, Jesus. Ah, yes, God. Yes, God. All right, brother, bring, shut it up for me. And hold on, let me say, read this word, the first verse to you. There is a reason why I have selected these songs that we're going to sing. Because we're going to look at the message is going to, we come, it's kind of good about the healing love of God. You say, why so simple? It is so simple because it is the most profound thing that ever happened to man. From the fall in the garden. Or let me say, before the garden, he knew what the love of God was. And from the fall, he never had it no more. We never had it no more. Thousands of years living this life without the love of God in our being. And no wonder we grew up crooked. Yeah, because the Lord told me one time, nobody grows up properly without my love.
That's right. Amen.
All right? So you ain't going to grow up properly unless you touch this realm of God's love in your being.
Yeah. Amen.
And God's love in your being nullifies sin.
Amen.
Because the love of God won't dwell in your being when you love sin. When you are yo in and out of sin, how will you enjoy the love of God? Because the background of the love of God is holiness.
Yes.
Holiness.
Yes.
For God to dwell in the soul, holiness.
Right.
Within and without.
Amina.
I know those online saying Amina. Brother Charles, help me out. Brother Christopher, help me out. And then. Oh, yeah. Brother, you just went 3 days and you lost all your voice. Huh? Brother, you lost all your voice over there shouting and casting out some devils? Oh, my goodness. I know you long for it. Hey, keep your voice, brother, because we're coming.
Amen.
All right, so. The love of God is a very powerful, you know, message because it's what brings healing.
Yeah.
And it's what brings wholeness.
Yeah.
When you walk and live and abide in the love of God, how comfortable it is, how sweet it is, how untroubled you are,
yeah,
how healthy you are, because you are in tune with Him who is life.
Mm-hmm.
You commune with Him who is life. I are you hearing me?
Mm-hmm.
I say, if ever you understood something, understand something tonight.
Yes.
Amen.
Understand something tomorrow.
Amen.
Understand something on Sunday.
Yes. Amen.
Ah, the love of God is greater, far than tongue or pen can ever tell. It goes beyond the highest star and reaches to the lowest hell. The guilty pair, you know them, bow down with care. God gave his son to win. His erring child he reconciled and pardoned from his sin. Oh, love of God. Hallelujah. Oh, love of God. How rich and pure. How measureless and strong. It shall forevermore endure the saints and angels' song. Ah, When years of time shall pass away and earthly thrones and kingdom fall, when men who hear refuse to pray, on rocks and hills and mountain call, God's love so sure shall still endure, all measureless and strong, redeeming grace to Adam's race, the saints and angels' song. Oh, love of God, how rich and pure, how measureless and strong, it shall forevermore endure. Woo! The saints and angels' song. Could we with ink the ocean fill, and were the skies of parchment made, where every stalk on earth a quill, and every man a scribe by trade, to write the love of God above would drain the ocean dry. Nor could the scroll contain the whole, though stretched from sky to sky. Oh, love of God, how rich and pure, how measureless and strong, it shall forevermore endure. The saints and angels' song. Now, what did Apostle Paul say? Now there abideth these three. What?
Faith,
hope, and the greatest.
Love.
Because love is God.
God is love.
Love is God. Give them love, and you give them God. You say, we don't understand how powerful love is. The love of God in our being. Give people the love of God, and you give them God.
Amen.
Give the sick man love of God, and you give them life. You give them healing. All right? So, Brother Dwayne, help me out with in a place. Play the song for me.
Amen.
The love of God is greater far than tongue or pen can ever tell. It goes beyond the highest star and reaches to the lowest hell. The guilty pair bow down with care. God gave his son and to win his erring child, he reconciled and pardoned from his sin. Oh, love of God, how rich and pure, how measureless and strong, it shall forevermore endure the saints and angels' song. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God.
Hallelujah.
When years of time shall pass away and earthly thrones and kingdom fall, when men who refuse to pray on rocks and hills and mountain call, God's love so sure shall still endure, all measureless and strong, redeeming grace to Adam's race, the saints and angels' song. Oh, love of God, how rich and pure, how measureless and strong, it shall forevermore endure, the saints and angels' song. Yes, God. Hallelujah to the Lamb.
Ooh. Worthy.
Yes, God. Could we with ink The ocean fail and where the skies are parchment made, where every storm roar on earthquake will, and every man has cried by woo to ride the love of God up. Yeah, will drain the ocean dry. Nor could the scroll contain the whole, though stretched from sky high to sky. Oh, love of God, yes, God, yes, God, how measureless. Oh, it shall forevermore endure, the saints and angels song. Oh, love of God, oh, how rich and oh, how measureless and strong. It shall forevermore endure, the saints and angels song. Oh, my goodness. My goodness. The love of God. Your portion. It is your inheritance.
That's right.
It's been given to you. Mm-hmm. What are you doing with it? The love of God is given. Are you all sons of God online? Have you all believed on Jesus Christ? Have you all received Jesus Christ in your being? Well, your portion in Christ is the love of God. That is yours. It's your bread. It is your bread.
Amen.
It is your bread. The love of God is the nourishment. The nourishment. Oh, my goodness. The best vitamins. Oh, yes, God. In the whole universe is the love of God. Because it has all the vitamins of life that you need in your being. The love of God. The love of Jehovah God. That is your portion in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Yes. Oh, yes, God.
Amen.
All right. All right, let's go on to. I stood outside the gate. You got it?
Amen.
I stood outside the gate. Because that is where we all used to be. Outside the covenant blessings of God, the gate was shut on every Gentile and every human being who never knew God. The gates were shut and we were kept out of the blessings of God in our being. But thank God, I cry to mercy. I cry to mercy. Mercy, have mercy upon me.
That's right.
Oh, mercy, loud I cried. Now give me rest from sin.
Hallelujah.
Woo! I will, a voice replied.
Yes.
Mercy replied and said, I'm going to give you rest.
That's right.
How can you be at rest? How can you be at rest when your sin, your body is tormented with sickness? How can you worship God with your whole being where your mind is tormented? Thinking about that, whether I'll survive this sickness or what I'm going to die.
That's right. Amen.
Quiet and time, Sonia, what great madness is this?
Amen.
That man brought himself into. But you will be free. I said, whoever you are, you will be freed from the torment of demonic sickness and demonic illnesses because of Jesus.
Amen.
I stood outside the gate. You got a song?
Amen.
All right, good. Do it for me. Can candy a song for me? Yes, bro.
Hallelujah.
Outside the gate. A poor wayfaring child Within my heart there be a tempest loud and wild. A fear oppress my soul that I may treat too late. And oh, I tremble sore and prayed outside the gate. Oh, and prayed outside the gate. Oh, mercy, loud I cried. Yes, God, now give me rest from sin. From sin I will a voice reply, and mercy let me in. May she bound my bleeding wounds and soothe my heart oppressed. She washed away my guilt, and gave me peace and rest. Oh, and gave me peace and rest. In mercy's guise I knew the Savior long abused, who often sought my heart and wept when I refused. Oh, what a blessed return for all my years of sin. I stood outside the gate, and Jesus let me in. Oh, and Jesus let me in. Oh, and Jesus let me in. Hallelujah. Jesus. Hallelujah. Jesus. Hallelujah. What is the end? What is the end? What is the end of the story? What is the end of the story? And Jesus let me in. And Jesus let me in. And Jesus opened his heart to me and healed me. Jesus let me in into his love, into his healing, into his strength, into his power. Jesus opened his heart to me and let me come in. In mercy's guise, I knew the Savior, long abused, who often sought my heart and wept when I refused. For all my years of sin, he said, oh, what a blessed return. For all my years of sin, I stood outside the gate. Amen. I was not counted among the saved. I was not counted among the blessed.
That's right.
But Jesus. Jesus, my Savior Jesus, let me in.
Glory be to you, Lord.
The door is open.
Amen.
Ah, Jesus, are you hearing me?
That's right.
You that are drinking the water, are you hearing me? Jesus, let you in.
Jesus
is bringing you in.
Amen.
Jesus is opening his heart to you in the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of God.
That's right.
And Jesus lets you in.
That's right.
Hallelujah.
Lord Jesus.
Hallelujah, Jesus.
Jesus. Yes, God.
Yes.
The last song. Yeah. Yes, God. How deep the Father's love for us. Ah, Jesus. My brethren, Jesus has opened the door. We ain't even started.
That's right.
Jesus let me in. Ah, yes, God.
Hallelujah.
Ah, Father God, how deep the Father's love for us.
Yes.
How vast beyond all measure. Mm-hmm. That he should give his only son and make a wretch his treasure.
Yeah.
I don't know about you, but me, I was a wretch. Because nobody find himself at the point of suicide who is good. He's wretched. He ain't got no hope.
Amen.
Ah, yes, God. Ah, yeah, he gave me his son and made a wretch his treasure.
That's right.
Now I am the treasure of God.
That's right.
Can you imagine a treasure?
Yes.
That God treasures.
That's right.
Because he got me out of the stranglehold.
Yes.
Of the demonic control.
Yes. Hallelujah.
And brought me to his glory. Jesus let me in.
Yes.
You don't find it?
Yes.
All right. Ah, yes, God. Yes, God. Thank you, Jesus.
Amen. What
is
name, Jesus?
Ah. The Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only son and make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss. The Father turns his face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one, bring shining sons to glory. My goodness. Behold the man upon his cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there, until it was accomplished. Dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. Ah, yes, God. I will not boast in anything, no gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart. Yes, his wounds have paid my ransom. Yes, Jesus, I showed again his reward. Why? I cannot give an answer. Can you?
No.
By this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer. By this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my... Oh my goodness. Do you know with all your heart that by his stripes, by his wounds, you had life. Ah, he paid my ransom. I was on the slave market of sin. Because that's where we were. Slave market of sin. The devil just kicking us anywhere he wants. Put sicknesses and infirmities on us. Diseases. Every kind of sin we were involved in.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
And now he comes along. Mm-hmm. Why should I gain from his reward? Mm-hmm. I cannot give an answer. Can you explain?
No.
Can you explain why Jesus did all that he did for us? But this I know. That his wounds. His wounds. His wounds brought me out from the slave market. His wounds brought me out from sicknesses and infirmities. Ah, shout unto God. Shout unto God.
Amina.
Thank you, Jesus.
Glory be to you, Lord.
Ah.
Amen.
I don't know. I cannot give any answer.
No.
You ask me? Why he did that for me, I don't know.
Love.
Maybe you know. Maybe you know, Brother Dwayne, because you are a teacher. Maybe you teach that. Brother. Pastor Phil, maybe you deliver some mail about that. I don't know. Maybe when you was in MIT, you were discussing how to make make some formula.
We are preaching
this love. Hallelujah.
I can't explain love.
I thought my philosophies in French will help me. Brought me down to the point of suicide. Can I give an answer?
No.
No.
No way.
But this I know.
Yes.
That's all I care about. His wounds. Have you seen them wounds? Have you seen them wounds of Jesus Christ?
Amen. This I know.
Have you seen the wounds that he bore on his body? Ah, Father God. Father, we thank you.
Yes.
We will never will understand what your son did on the cross for us. Nobody can ever fathom the humiliation, the deep agony. He who knew no sin, yet for our sake, he was willing to become sin. So that the very thing we never knew, the righteousness of God, could be given to us for free.
That's right. Yes. Wow.
Can you explain that?
No. No.
All you can do is that this I know. That's all I know, brother. This I know. His wounds.
Hallelujah.
His stripes.
Yes.
Opened the door for me to get healing.
Yes.
Opened the door for me to enjoy love.
Yes.
For me to be a human being.
Hallelujah.
I don't know about you, but I was no human being. No human being. No human being without God is a human being.
That's right.
He's a human something.
Yes.
But not the being God created.
Amen.
Because God created us in his image.
That's right.
Yeah.
And he came to restore the image back to us. In Christ Jesus.
Yes.
But this I know. That his image is now burning in my soul.
Hallelujah.
This I know, the image of Christ is now being revealed in me.
Hallelujah.
I don't know about you, but this I know.
Hallelujah.
I know there's something taking place in my being. I know there's a divine transformation. Do you know right now in your being? Do you know right now that Jesus Christ is transforming you? The blood is at work. The blood of Jesus Christ be upon you and heal you. The blood of Jesus.
Yes, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
This I know. I don't know about you, but this I know.
Yes.
this is what I know.
Yes.
That his blood works.
Yes.
What he did works.
Yes.
I said, this I know.
Yes.
What he did works.
I know.
He gave me love.
I know.
He gave me strength.
Amen.
He gave me eternal life.
Amen.
I don't know about you, but he gave me eternal peace.
Yes.
I got peace in my being.
Hallelujah.
I got love in my being.
Yes.
I got love in my soul.
Yes.
I got joy in my being.
Yes.
For this I know.
I
said, I know it.
You know.
I know in my being. This is my epignosis. This is my epignosis. It is increasing. This knowledge of Christ is increasing in my being. For this I know.
Hallelujah.
I know.
Hallelujah.
I don't know about you, but Pastor, I know. Who knows? Who knows among you? Who knows online? Let him shout. Who knows online? Let him shout. Who knows online? Let him or her shout. Shout.
Objectively, hallelujah.
Amen.
We know he paid it. Aspiration,
we know.
Glory to God.
Yeah. Yes, God. This
Amina.
I know.
And Amina.
This I know.
And Amina.
This I know.
I know.
I don't know about you, but this I know.
We know.
I know something. I know something. I know. Yes, God.
Yes,
brethren, it's a joy.
Oh,
it is a joy to walk with the Lord. It is a joy because there's no liberty anywhere except in Christ Jesus. There is freedom. There is liberty from sin, sickness, and infirmity, and disease, and death.
Amen.
Every child of God must possess this freedom.
Yes.
It is your portion. You can claim your freedom from the power of sin, from the power of sickness, from the power of death. I say in the name of Jesus, you claim your freedom. You claim your healing from Jesus.
Amen.
You better claim your healing.
Amen. We claim it all.
Amen.
Yes.
Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Listen. Let's go to the word. I woke up this morning going to write down a message from the Lord. And then I couldn't. I couldn't write it down. But something else was given to me. And I had to write it. So I sat down and I wrote it. I said, Lord, this is amazing. But let me read something to you. I said, I'm talking about the healing love of God. The healing love of God. Listen, this is your inheritance.
Amen.
Okay, by the time we finish going through the word of God, and the Holy Spirit open it up to you. Well, it's up to you to stay bound or to that girl. Say, no, devil, it's over.
That's right. Amen.
Devil, it is over.
Yes.
Yes.
Right. This is what the Lord led me to write by the Spirit of God. Okay, I wrote on top of it the death and resurrection of Christ Jesus. The death and resurrection of Christ Jesus, its implication for our life. Its implications for our life. Amazing. I just follow the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
But listen, I'm just going to read a small portion and then start the message from the Word. But this one, I want you to understand. Get this introduction of the message. Get this one. Because if you miss this one, I don't know how you're going to recover it.
Amen.
Get this, but this is a few more lines over here just to start that and let you understand where we're going. Mm-hmm. All right, I'll come back and read either today or tomorrow. But the death and resurrection of Christ Jesus, its implications for our life. When, listen to this, when on his cross, the Lord of life, our Savior Jesus Christ cried out, "Tetelestai, it is finished." When he cried out on the cross, "It is finished," he was signifying the end. He was signifying the end. Something has happened.
That's right. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Something. At that very moment.
That's right.
Something had been released.
That's right.
And no power on hell or on earth could ever stop what was released.
That's right. Amen.
From that cry, it is finished.
That's right. Amen.
The devil knew he's done.
That's right. Amen.
Them devils knew it is over.
Yes.
Three forces of satanic power were aware that they have been dethroned.
That's right.
Amen. I say, when Jesus cried out on the cross, "It is finished," he was signaling and signifying certain things have happened. When on his cross, the Lord of life, our Savior Jesus Christ, cried out, "It is finished," he was signifying the end of the reign and rule over the spirit, soul, and body.
That's right.
Remember what he was signifying.
Yes.
Remember what Christ was signifying.
Yes.
When he said, "It is finished."
Yes.
He knew what has been done. Mm-hmm. He knew what is about to, you know, to be released.
That's
that
right.
No force on earth or no force in heaven can stop it.
That's right.
Something new, and something had been released.
That's right.
A price had been paid.
Yes.
For something to be granted.
That's right.
For something to come into being.
Amen.
And you sit down there bound. Bound. You love your sickness, take it. But as of tonight, I say, you love your sickness, you can sit down there and then tap in, "Oh, sickness, hi, you in the Holy Ghost, sickness, how are you?" You can do that.
That's right.
Kick him out.
Yes, amen.
In the name of Jesus, curse that sickness.
Amen.
Jesus said, "It is finished, it is finished."
That's right.
You ain't going to have no control over me anymore.
Amen.
You foul sicknesses, you unclean spirits of iniquity, in the name of Jesus, it is finished. It is finished. It is
finished.
Thank you, Jesus. Let me go back again. We may not have finished just this small part. We want to go back there again. When on his cross, the Lord of life, our Savior Jesus Christ, cried out, "Tetelestai, it is finished."
That's right.
He was signifying. He was signaling the end of the reign and rule over the spirit, soul, and body of man.
Yes. Amen.
Over the spirit, soul, and body of man, the reign and rule by the satanic and demonic. Listen to that word, this word. The satanic and the demonic triumvirate.
Yes.
Write that word down.
Triumvirate.
T-R-I-U-M-V-I-R-A-T-E. Triumvirate of sin. The triumvirate of sin, sickness, and death.
Amen.
These are the three-pronged powers that Satan used to enslave man.
That's right.
Amen. And to dominate man completely.
Mm-hmm.
These are his bodies. These are the weapons the devil used to destroy man completely. They are called triumvirate. This is a Roman government term. A three member rulership. Julius Caesar Antony and then Brutus, something. They were vying. They were vying for the power to rule. The triumvirate was established in Rome. It's a three-pronged rulership. Okay, it's like the triune God, Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. The devil had his triumvirate, sin, sickness, and death. Who could escape? Who has been able to escape the control of these forces? Sin, sickness, death. That's how being the story of the human race. Don't you see it? Don't you see that everybody that ever left this world, sin, sickness, death. And if you didn't know God, lost forever. He was signaling the end of the regime and the reign and rule over the spirit, soul, and body of man by the satanic and demonic triumvirate of sin, sickness, and death. It's over. No, hear this now. I say he was signaling the end. The end has come for these.
Amen.
The end has come for these forces that have ruled over man, for sin that enslaved us. We are always in rebellion, always in disobedience, always doing the contrary to the will of God. Jesus said it is over. And Jesus said, the child of sin is sickness. Sickness comes because of sin.
That's right. Amen.
And the child of sickness is death.
Amen.
Death comes because men are sick and ill, and the illnesses kill them.
Amen.
That's how been the cycle of the human race. Are you hearing me now?
Amen.
And Jesus comes and says, it is over.
Yes,
now, listen. You listen to me. It is over. I said, Jesus said, it is over.
Amen.
The reign of sin is over. Sin shall have no more dominion over you. Why is it written? That sin henceforth will have no more power, control, or dominion over any soul of a child of God. Sin can no longer rule and lord it over you. I don't care who you are. If you allow sin, your sickness will remain. Because sickness came out of sin. And if you kill the mama, the daughter will die. That's how it is. You kill the mama called sin because sin brought forth sickness. And sickness brought forth death. You kill mama sickness, will death come on? He ain't coming until it is time for you to leave here and go to glory.
Amen.
Are you hearing me now?
Amen.
Listen. This what I'm saying to you is truth. Truth to heaven. I'm going to bring the word of God to you. I'm not going to read the rest. Right? Say here. Okay, maybe I can read a little bit. Let me read that. Okay. Jesus was signifying when he said it is finished. The end of the reign and rule over the spirit, soul, and body of man by the satanic and demonic triumvirate of sin, sickness, and death. The Lord of life, the triumphant Lord over the grave, on that resurrection Sunday. That's what he said. So he said, the death and resurrection. On that resurrection Sunday, the Lord of life dethrones, dethrones sin, sickness, and death. And in their place, the Lord of life, the triumphant Savior and deliverer of our soul, the Lord of life enthrones in the spirit, soul, and body of all those who will believe on him and receive him as Savior, deliverer, and Lord. He enthrones that wonderful life. He enthrones that wonderful life, the Father's promise and gift of eternal life. That indestructible and invincible, glorious, resurrected life was now to be the portion and inheritance of every child of God. This is what God led me to, you know, to write. I ain't finished, but that one is for tomorrow. Yeah, it's for tomorrow. But listen to that. Did you hear that?
Amen.
Did you hear this? No, you see, I said, you see, when we are walking with God, we don't walk with our fleshly mind. No, your fleshly mind don't live no more. You allow it to live. You are commanded to renew your mind in the word of God and think the way the word of God says to think. But if you keep on thinking in the fleshly, worldly ways, your sickness will remain. Because the sickness, you know, will continue to feed on the thoughts, how you feel about it. You feel oppressed, you feel this, and you complain, and all right, the sickness is happy. You do he's happy. He knows you ain't got no power over him. Because all you do is just complain. But if sickness hears you, say, in the name of Jesus, I was free from the power of sickness. I was freed from the torment of illness. I ain't gonna, you know, submit to it, you foul spirit of infirmity. When them sicknesses hear you talking like that, say, whoa, he knows what he's talking. He knows. That is their reaction. Ah, brother, we must hold on now because we must hold on because the way he's talking is dangerous now. He's releasing fire against us. When you quote the word of God,
that's right. Amen.
You are destroying the strength of the sickness.
Amen. That's right.
You are destroying the curse of cancer.
Amen.
When you attack it with the word of God,
that's right.
Knowing that Jesus Christ destroyed them. Jesus destroys their rule and reign in the mortal body.
That's right.
They don't have any control over a human body. I say sicknesses and cancer in the name of Jesus Christ. You got to confront it and curse it out with the word of God. And this I know. And this I know. By his wounds. By his stripes. Ah, he purchased my ransom. This I know. Do you know it? Do you know that Jesus purchased your ransom?
Amen.
So why are you still bound? Why are you sitting down there looking at the sickness to grow and have freedom to do what she like? Rise up in the name of Jesus and use the word of God. And speak the word of God against that sickness.
That's right. Amen.
Don't look at the sickness. Don't show the sickness mercy. You see, we are working in the realm of faith.
Yes.
In the realm of the spirit, it is faith alone that, you know, that counts.
That's right. Amen.
It's not your feelings. Mm-hmm. It is faith. What God says you can walk in. That's what you believe, and you walk in it. You go contrary to the sickness.
Yes.
Because they will let you feel, you know, in a pity party for yourself. Mm. And then sit down there, and then we are sing them, sing their song. He's singing. The devil say, do him good. He's singing. Mm. Yeah, he's singing what we want. Complaining. Mm. And talking against God. Mm. That God, how come? God, how come? And God will say, how come to you too? You know why God will say, how come? How come I have done something about your sickness and you accepting it? When on his cross, the Lord of life, our Savior Jesus Christ, cried out, "It is finished." It was Friday. It was Friday. It was Friday. Now we're crying now. He said it is finished. He was signifying the end. That something has come to an end. A rule has come to an end. A reign has come to an end. But it's not his reign. The reign of the devil. The reign of the devil over the soul of man. What is the Amen? Come on, let it flow. He was signifying the end of the reign and rule over the spirit, soul, and body of man by the satanic and demonic triumvirate of sin, sickness, and death. The Lord of life, the triumphant Lord over the grave, on that resurrection Sunday, dethrones Adas. Dethrones, bring down sin, sickness, and death. And then he enthrones in the spirit, soul, and body of all those who will believe on him and receive him as Savior, Deliverer, and Lord. He enthrones that wonderful life, the Father's promise and gift of eternal life, everlasting life. That indestructible and invincible, glorious, resurrected life was now, is now. I say was now, is now, the portion and inheritance of every child of God.
Amen.
I must preach it until you all get out here and say, "Yes, devil, it's over." I knew it was over, but you was tenacious. You wasn't giving me no room at all to think. You was always creating some pain in my body. And I was saying, I was singing your song. Ain't singing no more. Ain't singing the devil's song no more, brother. Sing the word of God.
Yes.
Tell the word of God. Speak to yourselves with psalms and hymns and spiritual songs.
Amen.
Making melody in your heart unto God.
Amen.
Praise the Lord in your sickness.
That's right. Amen.
Praise the Lord and speak the word of God over your life.
Amen.
Don't sit down there, let the devil run over you.
That's right.
All right. Okay, now let's go. Come with me. I tell you, come with me to John chapter 3. Notice how it began. Notice how it began. Man has sinned, and nobody was able to help him. All right, Moses came along. He brought the law. The law couldn't help man, but the law exposed man's sin. Because if you don't know you are a sinner, if you ain't broken no law.
That's right.
So the Lord gave them 10 commandments, and all other instructions, you know, to live by. They couldn't. They kept on breaking the law. The more they tried to walk in the law, the more they died.
That's right.
Because the law never brought life.
Yes.
The law told you what is right to do, but never showed you how to do it.
That's right.
So even though you said, I'm going to keep it, it was impossible to keep the law.
Amen.
You see that?
Yes.
You want to keep it? But the law itself tells you, the law itself says, brother, you can't keep me. Law, I want to keep. God said, I should live by. Say, yeah, but you cannot keep me. Because all I do is I expose you.
That's right.
I expose you and tell you a sinner. The more you try to do it, the more you say, oh my goodness, who would deliver me from this wretched body?
That's right.
Who? That's what the apostle found out.
Amen.
Are you hearing me?
Amen.
So that's how it started. And then the hour came. And here it says, for God loved and dearly prized the world, that he even gave up his only begotten unique son. Notice the beginning of the cure, the beginning of the hope, the beginning of the end of the triumvirate that ruled over the life of man, his soul, his spirit, soul, and body. And the devil was in charge of that oppressive power. This is the beginning, this word. For God so loved the world that he no longer abandoned it. He did not abandon it anymore. The law was not helping. So he realized that it's time. It's time to let the one who alone can dismantle the demonic structure of satanic oppressive power over man's soul. The time has come to send the one. To send the one who alone can dismantle it and deliver man. So he said, God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten son, that whosoever, notice, no, you see, you read it, but you don't pay attention to it. Whosoever believeth in him should not, he tell you, should not, you believe on him, should not. I don't care what the devil says. Are you hearing me? I say, I don't care what the devil is telling you about your sickness. God says, when I sent my son, you see, my son cried on the cross, it is finished. Amen. He was on a mission. Yes. I gave him an assignment. So I sent my son so that whosoever will believe on him should not. Yes. I say, he should not. Amen. He should not die. Amen. He should not be destroyed. Amen. He should not perish.
Amen.
He should not. He cannot. Why? He believed. He must not. The Father sent the devil a message. My son is coming. All ye powers of darkness, I'm sending you the message. My son is coming. When he comes, and then the people of earth begin to believe on him, they will not. They will no longer be your slaves. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. No longer. No longer. The Father said it. The Father said it. Son, when you go there and you tell them that I sent you and then that I came with a message for you, and my Father says, anybody who hears me, who sees me, and believes on what I say from the Father's heart about his love, and they believe me, they will not.
Hallelujah.
Jesus said, hey, son, they will not. Them devil said, you didn't say them devil will be able to. He said, they cannot. You should not perish. You should not be destroyed. No longer destroyed by sin and sicknesses and death. You ain't gonna die until God says it's time to come home. There'll be no premature death. You are 45 when you die. Quite untouched, what great madness. You will live to the end of your age. Apportioned to you by the Father God before you leave the earth. So he's telling you, devil, they will not. I've seen you kill them. I've seen you just bind them and drag them all these years. You enslaved them, destroyed them, but I sent my son. They will no longer be your slaves. I sent my son. And you heard, devil, you heard what my son said. It is finished. Father, I finished the work. Father, I finished the work. Tetelestai, it is over. Watch out, devils. Watch out, sickness. Watch out, death. No more. That's why it is good news. Good. Oh, my Lord. It was good news that destroyed the devil. I say it was good news that God sent to destroy the devil. Good news.
That's right.
To the human race, because all they had is bad news, bad news, bad news. This one, good news. Oh, my Lord. Tetelestai. It is finished. The Father and the Son said, hey, it's over. Jesus, what must you do? Just believe in me. And I'll give you that indestructible life. Wow. There is a life that cannot be destroyed. Yeah. I brought it. You watch and see. The devil is it ain't gonna kill me, but I'm coming out. I'm coming out on that Sunday. Hold on, okay? Jesus, are you sure you're coming out, brother? I'm coming out. The life, you cannot destroy this life. I'm going to give you the same life, okay? Oh, yeah. Hey, guys, you got some new life coming. Some new life coming. Let's go and believe on him.
Yes, God.
Whosoever believeth on him should not perish, should not be destroyed by sin, by sickness, and by death.
Amen.
Should not. I say, I don't care what the devil says, unless you allow him.
That's right.
I say, unless you allow the devil, you should not perish.
Yeah.
You say, on what authority do you say that? On Jesus' authority.
Mm-hmm.
On the life eternal. The one who is life eternal, it is on his authority that I say, I will not.
That's right.
I will not be destroyed.
No.
Sickness will not destroy me. Disease will not destroy me. COVID didn't even come near me. Azumaga. COVID didn't even come near. COVID. It didn't come near. Ooh, listen. When the Lord gave us one message, he said, You who are my children, you all do understand that because you are mine, if you walk close with me, sicknesses and diseases and demonic spirits, they see me in you and they are scared of you. Sicknesses and devils are scared of my children. Are you a child of God or you just go to church? Have you put on Christ? Is Christ indwelling you, filled with the glory of God in your being? Them devils see Jesus inside you. They ain't coming there.
Amina.
You see, I don't know how many of you are online, but how many are saying Amina?
Mm.
You ain't saying no Amina. I don't see those who are saying Amina. Amina, Amina, you are too far. Come close. Yes, God. Yeah. Help me out. Where's Brother Charles? Brethren, this is good news.
Amen.
Right? He said, but I want you to understand that it was a mission Jesus came on. A divine mission to end the rulership over the soul of man of sickness, of sin, sickness and infirmity and death. It is a divine mission. He came on. Do you think Jesus Christ will finish the assignment given to him? Do you believe he will finish it? But he finished it. He tell you it is finished. Christ is saying it is finished. And what are you going to say about that? He ain't finished. All right, you can take your sickness. You can take your infirmity, diseases. If it ain't finished, carry it on. Go on and go to your church. Sing in the choir with your diseases. Brother, listen to me. Jesus said it. The Father sent him to come and tell us that if anybody sees him and believes on him, that he is the Son of God who came from heaven, who came with good news, and they believe on him, the Father says, give them the guarantee that they will not perish.
That's right.
Yes. Thank you, Lord.
But what is it that makes them perish? You know, sin, sickness, and disease, and death. Yes. But Father said they will not perish. So it means the power of sin will be ended.
That's right.
When you receive Jesus Christ. The power of sickness will be ended.
Yes.
The power of death is come to an end.
Amen.
You will only die when it is time to go home.
Yes,
but how many people are going to hell prematurely? If they had stayed on earth for some time, maybe God would have shown them mercy and saved them. But the devil said, no, kick him here. Take him out. Let him go to hell. Listen, I want you to build your confidence, total confidence on this word tonight. The assignment was fulfilled by Jesus Christ. Right? Sin was destroyed. He became sin so that we might become the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. All right, he who knew no sin. All right, for our sake he became sin.
Amen.
Are you hearing me now?
That's right.
And sicknesses are no more. Because what? By his stripes we were made whole. They beat him.
Yes.
The punishment was given to him. He paid the price for your sicknesses.
Amen.
So why are you going to carry it? Have you forgotten when we read Rich House, the intercessor? When we were doing the first time that God gave Rich House, you know, a healing prayer, that he said, I've been praying salvation and help and all that thing, but I've never prayed for healing. So when God said, all right, he should go and fast and wait upon him, he was reading the word of God, reading the word of God. When the officer, he said, there began to take hold of me the conviction that Jesus died. Jesus died for our sicknesses. They beat him by his stripe. If he paid it and took our sicknesses in his own body, then we don't have it no more.
That's right.
If Jesus carried our sicknesses, why should we carry it?
That's right.
I say, if Jesus carried your sicknesses, why should you carry it in your bodies? Are you hearing?
Amen.
And so he began, Rishal said, I began to offer healing to the people. And God healed them.
Hallelujah.
You begin to offer healing to the people. Offer healing to the people in the name of Jesus Christ. The one who bore your sicknesses is the one who heals.
Amen.
Are you hearing me now? I'm asking you. Jesus Christ was sent on a mission to come and destroy sin, sickness, and death.
That's right.
But he had to do that by taking the paying the price for it. They beat him. They tore his flesh. He became sin. All right? And then they killed him. He died. He had to die. So that death will no longer rule over the human race, because he conquered death. He destroyed. He went into hell to destroy death. Oh, death, where is your power? Because if death had retained Christ, then that would be the end for us. Mm-hmm. But death could not retain Christ in the grave.
Amen.
Are you hearing me now? Mm-hmm. So the three powers, sin, sickness, and death, have all been dethroned.
Yeah.
They have all been dethroned.
Hallelujah.
My brother, my sister, you have access to the gift of God. You can receive your healing.
Amen.
You can receive your deliverance.
Amen.
You can receive whatever God says Jesus did for you.
Amen.
It is yours. Are you hearing me?
Amen.
The only thing that hinders them is the one word God has said in his word. For without faith, it is impossible.
That's right. Amen.
And don't tell me you don't have faith, because if you don't have faith, how are you saved? Because it is by faith, all right? It is by grace through faith that we are saved,
mm-hmm.
And that's not our own, you know, work. It is the work of God. It is the gift of God, right? To give us faith to believe Him. You have faith. If you don't have faith, start reading the Word of God. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. Some of you, let me tell you something. The time you spend in the Word of God is just 30 minutes. 30 minutes, you want to get some good word? You want to get some good word in 30 minutes reading? What are you talking about? Why is the Lord telling us to rise in the night? Not you, He ain't told you. But I know He told us. And we've been doing this almost 7 years. In the night. To read the Word of God for 2 or 3 hours.
That's right.
And then the rest of the night, blasting the Holy Ghost.
Mm-hmm.
Blasting the Holy Ghost. Talk them tongues.
Yes,
praying the Spirit for hours.
Mm.
Where did I start getting these revelations from? By absorbing the Word of God.
Amen.
By blasting the Holy Ghost.
The Holy Ghost.
And reading the Word of God.
Amen.
And reading the Word of God. And then fasting, doing the four pillars of the inner life. The Word of God, prayer, fasting, the Holy Ghost.
Yeah.
There is an expansion in my being.
Yes.
And brother, it's just the beginning. That hour is coming, the hour is coming, it shall be explosive.
Yes.
Because the Word of God will explode in your being.
Amen.
The Holy Ghost will explode through the Word of God.
Amen.
And who can stop you?
That's right.
Listen to me. Jesus came on assignment. Did he finish?
Sure.
Did he carry it out?
Yes.
What tells you that he carried it out?
Resurrection. Resurrected.
It is finished.
You see,
accepted by God.
He said it is finished.
Mm-hmm.
When he said it is finished, then he hung his head.
Mm-hmm.
He gave up the spirit. And then he was gone down there now to go and do the other part.
Mm-hmm.
Follow them down there. I would have loved to be down there watching the fight.
Mm-hmm.
That took place between Jesus and the devil down there in the pit of darkness. Because he descended into hell. Huh? You don't believe he went to hell?
He went to hell.
Oh yeah, he went to hell, brother.
He went there
where he was supposed to go. That's the reason why we don't go to hell when you believe on Jesus, because he went there for us.
That's right. Amen. Amen.
Okay, he took our place.
Yes.
Yeah.
On the cross, he took our place in the grave, in the tomb.
Amen.
And he rose up and we rose with him.
That's right.
Ah,
Amen.
Jesus.
Yeah.
I just feel like I have to just leave you with this thought. Jesus was on assignment, divine assignment, to come and bring to an end the lawless rule of satanic forces over the soul of man,
mm-hmm.
his spirit, soul, and body.
Mm-hmm.
The lawless rule of sin, sickness, and death to end their rule, to bring them all to an end.
That's right.
Now, can sin dominate you anymore unless you allow it?
No.
Can sickness take hold of you if you are careful and walking close to the Lord?
No.
Are you hearing me?
Amen.
Walk close to the Lord. I told you some months ago, or some a year ago, that the Lord said after COVID, whoever will not learn to abide in him cannot make it. So in Christ alone, my hope is found.
Amen.
In Christ alone is my deliverance. In Christ alone, I have hope. In Christ alone, I have victory over sin, sickness, and death. Ah, let me read something to you. I'm going to read this. I'm going to finish it. Let me finish it. I feel I should finish it for this message. Okay. But my real concern is that you understand that Christ came on a mission. He didn't come to play. He came to end a rogue regime. A rogue, it's not a Biden regime, but it's close to a rogue regime, satanic regime, that he has exercised over the soul of man. For centuries, Satan has dominated the human race. But now, towards the end of the age, the father says, son, it is time. Go down there and put an end to it. Mm-hmm. But you are going to have to go through it for them. So Christ came here. It was wonderful. Right? It was wonderful. But let me do this before. Let me do this. Let me do this. Come. Come with me and see the beginning of when he put the mission in motion. Come with me to John chapter 12, when Jesus put the motion, the mission, all right, on cruise control, going towards the cross, right? You hear John 12. When the Greeks came and said, sir, we will see Jesus. You know that? Mm-hmm. Sir, we will see Jesus. Then he says here. Ah. He said, Philip came. He said, now look at verse 20. John 12:20. He says here. Now among those who went up to worship at the feast were some Greeks. These came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and they made this request, sir, we desire to see Jesus. There's going to be a shift here into cruise control, because from here, his face is towards the cross. He know it is time, because the people are hungry. They are tired of the Pharisaic conventions and all the conferences. They are tired. This one was too much for them. So, hey, sir, can we see Jesus? Can we have us? We came to come and listen to the prophet who had the word of life. And now since we came to the Pharisees and this First Presbyterian Church and First the Pentecostal Assembly and third, sir, we are Greeks. We don't know nothing about this worship. But we heard that there is a prophet. He got life.
Amen.
He said he has power over sin, sickness, and death. So we came so he can help us. So I say here. These came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee. And they made this request, sir, we desire to see Jesus. Philip came and told Andrew. And Andrew and Philip, together went and told Jesus. And Jesus answered. Listen to what he said. When he heard this, something kicked in his spirit. Yes. Now I must go. Now I must direct my attention to the fulfillment of the mission. Because now he's been doing some good work, good teaching. Good teaching, but he ain't the work. It's not bringing an end to the rule of Satan. Good teaching, right? And miracles and signs and parables. He's been doing that, right? But when the Greeks came and said, "Sir, want to see Jesus? That's why we came here. We've been coming to this celebration of the festival every year. Ain't nothing there. But we heard that he's in town.
Yeah, come on.
So we don't want some Pharisaic displays. We don't want some conferences that woman thou art loose and we are still bound. Ah, we don't want that no more." Then he says here, and Jesus answered them, "The time has come." You hear that?
Yes.
"The time has come for the Son of Man to be glorified and exalted." Malango Zabrangas. Woo! "I assure you, most solemnly I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains just one grain." And up till now, who was that one grain?
Christ.
The one grain of life that came and lived among us is still living, but it must die. He knew it, that unless they bury him, he ain't going to bear fruit. He will still be one grain. He knew the spirit law. Just one grain. It never becomes more, but lives by itself alone. And what happened to Jesus, I tell you, must happen to you, must happen to me. Our lives must come to an end. And a new life coming from the new man in us must now spring forth and bear fruit to the glory of God. It says here, "But if it dies, it produces many others and yields a rich harvest. Anyone who loves his life, right, loses it. But anyone who hates his life in this world will keep it to eternal life. Whoever has no love for, no concern for, no regard for his life here on earth, but despises it, preserves his life forever and ever. If anyone serves me, he must continue to follow me, to cleave steadfastly to me, conform wholly to my example in living, and if need be, in dying. And wherever I am, there will my servant be also. If anyone serves me, the Father will honor him." Now listen. "Now my soul is troubled and distressed. And what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour of trial and agony? No, but it was for this very purpose that I have come to this hour, that I might undergo it." There you have it.
Amen.
I have come this far.
Yes.
Why will I turn back? My Father sent me on a mission. Mm-hmm. I have up till now been the only one grain that gives life. No one else around gives life. But the people need eternal life. They need the life inside me to be multiplied. So I must go. I must go to the cross. Are you hearing me?
Amen.
Now come with me to chapter 13. Now, verse 1. Remember, the trajectory is what we are following. When the hour came for him to go. Now, before the Passover feast began, Jesus knew and us. He knew, Jesus knew, was fully aware that the time had come for him to leave this world. The mission is coming to an end. I must obtain the result of my coming down here. I must carry my Father's mission to an end successfully. I must be able to open the door of salvation, open the door of healing, open the door of forgiveness, open the door to live eternally.
Yes.
I must do that.
Amen.
He says here, the time had come for him to leave this world and return to the Father. And as he had loved those who were his own in the world, he loved them to the last and to the highest degree.
Amen.
My goodness.
Amen.
He's been walking with them for 3 years now. It's the end. 3 years is coming to an end. He's going to go to Jerusalem the last time and be crucified. He knew it. So on this last trip here, because every year he went to Jerusalem for the 3 years of his ministry. The third year is this. And he's going to Jerusalem. And he knew that he has to die. He knew he has to pay the price. He knew he has to end the illegal rule of Satan over the souls of men. And he knew he had to be a ransom. He had to be the ransom for us. He's going to surrender. Huzzah. He's going to surrender. No man take my life from me. I lay down by myself. I have power to lay it down and power to take it back up. So my Father commanded me. Listen. Now look at before I continue here. Look at St. Luke chapter 9. St. Luke, Gospel of Luke chapter 9. So that you put the two together. It's the longest chapter. It's the longest chapter. Yes, God. The longest chapter in Luke is about 62 verses. Verse 50. Yes, God. Verse 51. Now, when the time was almost come for Jesus to be received up to heaven. You hear that? To be received. Remember, don't forget, he came on a mission. He started it when John the Baptist came on in, opened the door for him to be baptized. And then there he went into the wilderness to be tempted. All right, then he began, okay, to raise up disciples. And then he began to teach and to heal and to give parables and all kinds of miracles. Then as the years, second year, third year, in the third year he knew certain things must now come to an end. The rule of Satan must now be ended. It's an illegal occupation because he lied to man and took away the authority.
Amen.
And he knew he has to end it. Mm-hmm. And he knew the price he's going to pay to end the rule of sin, to end the rule of sickness, to end the rule of death over the souls of men. He knew it. That's why he came. He knew man needed the life inside him, but he had to show it first by dying. Hanzo Jagaranda. He had to show the life by dying. So he will be raised up by his Father. So now he has the resurrection life. Jesus. Listen, you say here. In that same hour. We are in Luke. Okay. Where is Luke? Okay, chapter 50. Did I go wrong? Yeah. What? I'm in chapter 11. All right, chapter 9, verse, all right, 51. And now when the time was almost come for Jesus to be received up to heaven, he stepped and dashed. That's not a man we're going to back down. Jesus was not a man who going to back down before devils.
Amen.
He steadfastly and determinedly set his face to go to Jerusalem.
That's right.
There he will die.
Mm-hmm.
and not before. Ooh, steadfastly. So now we are reading it in John. It says here, now before the Passover feast, okay, began, Jesus knew, John 13, Jesus knew, was fully aware that the time had come for him to leave this world and return to the Father. And as he has loved those who were his own, he has loved them. So notice, everything that Christ has been doing, the motive was to release the love of God in their life. Amen. To show them how much God cared, how much God loved them, healing them, miracles, signs, wonders, raising up the dead. It's all to show them the caring love of Jesus.
That's right.
The healing love of Jesus.
Amen.
To care for human beings made in his image.
That's right.
So he said he had loved them. Ooh. He loved the apostles. My goodness. See John. See John. You see John lying in his bosom. Ooh, like a child in the mother's bosom. Ooh, like a child is my soul weaned from fretting. Ooh, yes, God. You say here. And as he had loved those who were his own in the world, he loved them to the last and to the highest degree. And what is the detail of the meaning of this word? He loved them to the highest degree. What does it entail? Do you see the cross? Do you see the cross in this word? He loved them to the highest degree. Everything else he's going to do from this point on is about the cross. It's about the sufferings. And he started to tell them, listen, In a few days, it will be the Passover, and the Son of Man will be delivered over into the hands of the Gentiles. They will spit on him. They will beat him. They will do all this. He started to prepare them for it, because he knew that's what he came for. The miracles was nice. Nobody fled when he made miracles, but now they're gonna flee him. He knew it. Because they couldn't handle the pain and the anguish of their master, whom they have known alone for 3 years, now leaving them. So remember, what I've read here, the content. All right, let me read some to you. The content is, let me go there. What's going to happen to him on the sufferings? Read the gospel and then see the sufferings. Right? Matthew 26, 27. Okay, you will see it. The suffering. Look in the gospel, you read about it. And then also look in the prophets. That is the content of this sentence here. And as he had loved those who were his own in the world, now he loved them to the last and the highest degree. Can any man, love someone to the highest degree except, by laying down his life? And that's what he said. No man, all right, can do this, okay, except he really means business.
That's right.
It is love that sent Jesus, and love that he would display. The detail of that love, go and read Psalm 22, you see the detail of that love. Go and read Isaiah 52, the last four verses into 53. Okay, you see, it's all about the cross. It's all about what the Father did. It's all about what the Father allowed the Son to go through to demonstrate his love. All right, let me read a little bit of Isaiah 53 and then draw your attention to it. Okay, Isaiah 53. Understand, remember, I'm trying to explain to you when he said, having loved those who are his own in the world, he loved them to the highest degree. Mm-hmm. And the highest degree, all right, it's everything they did to him that he went through willingly.
Yes.
He went through because he loved them.
Amen.
That is the highest degree. Look at Isaiah 53. All right. It says here. All right, probably let me look at 52, the end. The end of verse 14, Isaiah 52, verse 14, and we're going to read through Isaiah 53. This is the content of the love that he showed. Read Psalm 22, the content of what the love was. My father, why hast thou forsaken me? For whose sake? Well, is he being forsaken? For us, it is part of the plan, part of the price to pay, to break the dominion of Satan over our soul, over our spirit, over our body, to release us from the control of sin, sickness, and death. The price is what is being described here. Look at Isaiah 52, verse 13. Behold, my servant shall deal wisely and shall prosper. He shall be exalted and extolled and shall stand very high. For many, the servant of God became an object of what? An object of horror? Is that love? Can love go this down? This low? Yes, it is genuine love that can go this far. It is genuine divine love that alone can descend into this pit. Where the beloved one becomes an object of horror. To deliver us. To what? To deliver, to free a wretch like me. I remember, you know, I can tell you, I'll never forget. Anytime I read this, I have to tell you what the Lord said about it. The Lord told us about this very passage. He said, when they finish with me, beating me and tearing me up, I was like a beast. I did not look like a human being. And the Lord is like some deep emotional tone with which he spoke to us. You could feel, my goodness, the agony in his soul. He said, my children, they beat me. They tortured me. And I felt every pain. He said, don't tell me I didn't feel it. I felt every pain in my body. He said, your do your movie called what? The Passion of the Christ. He said, that don't come nowhere near what I went through. He said, that passion, that's for you human being, but you cannot feel, you cannot come where I was. No human being can descend there. It was horror. He said, how I survived was known to me and my father. Oh, my goodness. Brother, they tortured him. Mm-hmm. All right? They tortured him. It says here, for many, the servant of God became an object of horror. Many were astonished at him, his face, and his whole appearance were marred. More than any man's, and his form beyond that of the sun. You hear that? His form don't look like a human being. So when the Lord said, son, I didn't look like a human being when they finished with me, it's true, because the word of God bear witness that the prophet Isaiah described it. And you think, listen, sons of God, you think your father God will subject his son to this just to play church with you? Just to play church with your illnesses and diseases, and he ain't gonna heal you? Come on, somebody, tell me something. Do you think God will subject his son to this torture and play with your sicknesses? Play with sin in your life? Play with death? This is your inheritance. You better rise up and take hold of your healing. You better rise up and take hold of the word of God.
Amen.
And stand tall and bring glory to God.
Amen.
For God will heal, and God has healed. The love of God is a healing love.
Amen.
Listen to me. You don't have no excuse now. If you ain't healed, you don't have no excuse. Because nobody will go down beyond this. This is the same word that makes Jesus do miracles, signs and wonders, mighty signs. This is what John G. Lake knew. This is what Smith Wigglesworth them knew. This is what Ora Robert Kenneth Hagin, this is what they knew.
Amen.
Sambach, this is what they all knew. Stood on this word. It said here, his face, his whole appearance were marred more than any man's, and his form beyond that of the sons of men. But just as many were astonished at him, so shall he startle and sprinkle many nations, and kings shall shut their mouth because of him. For that which has not been told them, they shall see it. And that which they have not heard, shall they consider and understand.
Amen.
Jesus' death opens the door to every realm of the human life to come face to face with the healing power of Jesus. To come face to face with what God has wrought for the human race. It doesn't matter what your sickness is. It doesn't matter whether you are dumb, you are mute. I've seen deaf ears open by just the word of God. I've seen the blind see by the word of God. I've seen the cripple walk ask Brother Charles, he was there. He was there in Togo. Okay, I've seen in the Ivory Coast. I've never seen so many deaf mutes opened, that their mouth and their ears open. I was coming from the Ivory Coast, at the airport, some woman met me. She said, Pastor. I said, yeah, why do I know? She said, I was at the crusade. He said, oh, I thank God, my son, for the first time, his ear was open, his mouth was open. Ain't that something? You think Jesus is playing with your sickness and disease? You got healing in the love of God. This is the love of God displayed. When Christ hung on the cross, this is love.
Hallelujah.
He says here, who has believed? That's the problem. Who has believed, trusted in, relied upon, and clung to our message of that which was revealed to us? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been disclosed? For the servant of God grew up before him like a tender plant, and like a root out of the dry ground. Ain't no ground that this root will not grow in. I say, ain't no ground that this root of Jesse will not come out of. A ground, hard ground, watery ground, miry clay ground, whatever ground, put this root in there. He coming out. Put Jesus Christ in your miry clay lifestyle, and he coming out. He going to grow.
Amen.
Dry ground, waterless ground, the root of Jesse will grow.
Amen. Amen.
Put Jesus in your soul.
Yes.
He will grow up.
Right.
And destroy the leftovers of satanic forces. For the servant of God grew up before him like a tender plant and like a root out of the dry ground. He has no form or comeliness, no royal kingly pomp that we should look at him, and no beauty that we should desire him. If God sent, you think God sending his his son, you know, he knows the woman on earth. He knows how they have eyes. They'll be looking at him. They'll be trying to make them wink at Jesus. Some will try to take some food to Jesus' house. Yeah. Winking at Jesus. God knows. He knows they will be doing all that, so he didn't make him beautiful. Oh no, he didn't make him a rugged man. Woo! A rugged young man, 33 years old, in the prime of his life. He said he has no kingly pomp that we should look at him, no beauty that we should desire him. But I want to tell you something. Even though there's no physical beauty that we should desire him, there is every beauty spirit-wise that we need to desire him. He who sees Jesus in the spirit, brother, you ain't going nowhere when you see him in the spirit. You following him. There ain't no beauty that surpasses the divine holy beauty in the Son of God. Clean, pure heart. Jesus. Strong, rugged muscles. Yeah, oh my Lord. So that we should look at him and no beauty that we should desire him. He was despised, of course, and rejected and forsaken by men, a man of sorrows and pains, and acquainted with grief and sicknesses. And like one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised, and we did not appreciate his worth or have any esteem for him. Look at him, man of sorrows, what a name. Given to the Son of God who came. Ruined sinners to reclaim. Hallelujah. What a Savior. What a Savior. He came to reclaim ruined sinners. Surely he has borne our griefs, sicknesses, weaknesses, and distresses. He did what? He put them in his pocket. Where? He bore it in his own body. He carried your sicknesses, your infirmities in his own body. The sicknesses and the diseases went into his own body. He carried them. And he hung on the cross with your sicknesses. Now you want to still carry sickness in your body? Quiet down, you said that the guy carried your sicknesses. Why are you going to sit down there just pampering your sickness? Yeah, sickness, how are you? How are you feeling today? Sickness. Stay there, okay? Don't go nowhere. I'm going to church. Yeah, I want to go to church too. Oh, come on. Sickness, I want to go to church too. And he said, come along. And when he come, no pastor, I'm going to preach no word to kill that sickness. And he said, see, your pastor, I don't see now. He didn't see me. Sickness, you are lying. Oh no, I saw him. I was looking at him. I'm saying, I'm here. Hey, pastor, I'm here. Woo-hoo, I'm here. He didn't say nothing. He didn't say no word against me. The pastor is blind. Your pastor was blind. He didn't see me. yes, God. He says here, surely he has borne our griefs. In other words, sicknesses, weaknesses, and distresses, and carried our sorrows and pains of punishment. Yet we ignorantly considered him stricken, smitten, and afflicted by God as if with leprosy. Look at the human being. They see this man hanging on the cross. That's the judgment of God upon him because he wasn't right. Hey, he said he's a son of God. If God loves you, let him come and take him down. He said he's son of God. They were mocking at him. And yet it was for you he was dying. He was bruised, but he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our guilt and iniquities. The chastisement, the punishment needful to obtain peace and well-being for us was upon him. And with the stripes that wounded him, we are healed and made whole.
Amen. Hallelujah.
And you still want to walk in your sicknesses? All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord has made to light upon him the guilt and iniquity of us all. Brother, if I was the one carrying yours, but if you ain't going to carry your iniquity and sicknesses on my body, I ain't doing that, but I ain't going to do for you. I may do for my wife, but not for anybody. Ooh. No. I ain't going to do for nobody at midnight. Ooh. Yes, God. Brother, this is serious. He says, all we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord has made to light upon him the guilt and iniquity of us all. He was oppressed. Yes, when he was afflicted, he was submit among God. Brother, I ain't doing that. I come to die for you. And then what? I should sit down quiet, let them abuse me, insult me, and I keep quiet. I will talk, brother. I say, I will talk something. I'll make some faces. brother. I'll be saying, okay. I'll get you. I'll get you one day, okay? I make some eye to let him know, hey, pilot, you okay? yes, God. He says, he was oppressed. Yes, when he was afflicted, he was submissive and opened not his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shearers is dumb, so he opened not his mouth. By oppression and judgment, he was taken away. And as for his generation, who among all of us, who among all the human race, considered that he was cut off, or cut off of the land of the living, stricken to his death for the transgression of my people, to whom the stroke was due? Who of us thought that it was for our transgression that he was bruised? We didn't think that it's for him. Maybe he did something wrong. So God was punishing him. And they assigned him a grave with the wicked. Wow, the guy ain't done no wrong. But for your sake, he had to go and be among the wicked to end your wickedness, to secure forgiveness for your sins. Yes, God. He said here, and they assigned him a grave with the wicked and with the rich man in his death. Although he had done no violence, neither was any deceit in his mouth. Yet, it was the will of the Lord to bruise him. My goodness. You see that? And he allowed. He allowed himself to be bruised. He allowed. But all right, let's see what it means here. Now, before the Passover feast began, Jesus knew, was fully aware. We just read that, right? I wrote that to you. I said, hold on. We are going to look at the content of this love. That's why we turn to Isaiah. Okay, now I'm going to go back again and read that. Now, before the Passover feast began, Jesus knew, was fully aware that the time had come for him to leave this world and return to the Father. And as he had loved those who were his own in the world, as he has loved them, walked with them in love, now, near the time where he should be crucified, he loved them to the last and to the highest degree. And the highest degree is what we are reading from Isaiah. There was no height and depth he didn't descend to purchase salvation, forgiveness, healing, and deliverance for the people. I want to tell you something. Jesus Christ paid the price. You don't have to bear your sicknesses.
That's right. Amen.
You don't have to be afflicted by your diseases. You can have the healing and deliverance now.
Amen.
So let me read Isaiah. Let me finish it. Say here. Yet it was the will of the Lord to bruise him. He has put him to grief and made him sick. When you and he make his life an offering for sin, and he has risen from the dead in time to come, he shall see his spiritual offspring. He shall prolong his days, and the will and pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. He shall see the fruit of the travail of his soul and be satisfied. By his knowledge of himself, which he possesses and imparts to others, shall my uncompromisingly righteous one, my servant, justify many and make many righteous, upright, and in right standing with God. For he shall bear their iniquities and their guilt with the consequences, says the Lord. Therefore will I divide him a portion with the great kings and rulers, and he shall divide the spoil with the mighty, because he poured out his life unto death, and he let himself be regarded as a criminal. He was willing for the people to mock at him and regard him as a criminal. And be numbered with the transgressors. Yet he bore and took away the sin of many and made intercessions for the transgressors, the rebellious. Hallelujah. This is the content of the highest degree of love. The highest degree of love that the Lord showed. This is the content. Look, read the Gospels when he was being crucified. Read it, and then read Isaiah 53. Read Psalm 22. My Lord, my Lord, my Father, why hast thou forsaken? He said, bulls of Bashan have compassed me. Wild dogs. Because in the spirit, the people look like demonic spirits. That's who they were. Surrounded. All them devils were there.
That's right, yes.
He said, wild bulls of Bashan. Wild dogs.
Yes.
They had come to execute me, executioner. Brethren, can anybody show this kind of love? So I'm asking you, did Jesus complete his mission? Did he finish what he came here to do? Did he purchase your forgiveness for sins? Did he purchase your healing from diseases and sicknesses?
Absolutely.
Did he purchase your resurrection or your deliverance from the power of death?
Yes.
So why do you want to bear your sickness? You love it so much?
Suma
kwaitanta. Why do we want to carry our sickness? I'm asking you online. Why do you want to go through your problems? Why don't you give it to Jesus? Why don't you take the word of God and read the word of God and claim what belongs to you in the name of Jesus? Why are you going to be tortured? You see, listen, the only cure for cancer is Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Complete and total cure. And he bore the punishment for it. You don't have to carry it no more in the name of Jesus Christ. You can receive it. You can give your sickness to Jesus tonight. Give it to Jesus tonight and say, Son of God, you took my sicknesses upon your own body. I will no longer buy it. I don't buy it from the devil no more.
Amen. By faith.
By faith, I have access to healing. You have been delivered by Jesus. All you need is to go into another gear and just take your faith and rise to him. Another thing that you have access to is abiding in him. Listen. The man is a healer, okay? He's a deliverer, he's a life giver. And you dwell in him, and he in you. Have you forgotten January 23rd? All right, in God calling? Somebody tell me what? the power of abiding. What is that?
How power comes.
How does it come? Describe it. Insensibly. Say anyone who is in close contact with Jesus Christ, with him, all right? He doesn't have to even give you a gift of healing. Why? Because the healing flows from his own being directly into your being because you are so close to him. So close a contact. That is the reason why he said, abide in me. Can you be any closer than living inside him by faith in Jesus Christ? Can you be any closer than abiding your heart-to-heart fellowship with Christ? Whatever is in him is yours. It flows. You are a partaker. Get the word of God and take your time and read it and see what has been given to you. You are to become what? A partaker of the divine nature. Is there sickness in the divine nature, my brothers? Is there poverty in the divine nature? Is there death in the divine nature? So why? Why don't you want to abide in him and receive life? Listen, I haven't come to do nothing but to bring your attention back to this truth.
That's right.
And I'm going to just pray a simple prayer.
Amina.
Just ask the Lord, I have carried the burden in my soul. Because to me, it's a disgrace to the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. That he said he has paid the price. And yet we all go around sick in our bodies. And the devil is mocking at him. No! Rise up and take your place in Christ and receive the healing that belongs to you. Rise up in blood. How violent are you? He said the kingdom of God suffers violent. And it is the smooth guys that take it by force. May I get some water? Water inside here. Huh? It's the smooth guy that receive what, the deliverance from God, or the violent one? Yes, God. My Jesus, have mercy upon me. That's good water. Jesus. You see, I've told the Lord, I said, Lord, the people, your people, we have to walk with you in union. We have to walk in what you purchased for us. And so I'm asking you, heal them. Heal them so they will bring glory to you. I'm asking you, Lord, it doesn't make no sense that you paid the price. But what is the result? What Jesus must have? He paid the price. But what are the consequences of healings and deliverances and all that, the testimonies, what are they? Are you hearing me?
Yes, God. Amen.
So, beloved, it's time for us to rise.
Yes.
And say, Jesus, enough is enough. We brought so much shame to you, but now we are ready. Now let us arise. And take hold of faith.
Yes.
And receive it.
Yes.
Receive the prayer.
Yes.
Receive the healing.
Yes.
Receive the forgiveness.
Mm-hmm.
Receive the deliverance.
That's right.
In your life. I don't care what it is. Me, I don't care what it is. Jesus Christ paid the price.
That's right. Yes.
And I'm not the one going to heal you. Jesus Christ lives inside me.
Amen.
And I believe him.
Amen.
So are you ready to receive healing?
Are
you ready to receive healing, those online? Are you ready to let Jesus Christ visit you and touch you?
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Why will this thing be so hard? It ain't no hard. give him and thank him. If I had something, I say, hey, this is for you. What will you do? So, yeah, is it for me? I say, it's for you. Oh, yeah, I don't believe that it's for you. But I say, it's for you, brother, take it. No, I don't know. Sit down there and die, brother.
I'm scared.
I'm scared about it. You're scared what? I said, the Jesus we're talking about, all right, he did it all for you.
Amen.
Give it all to Jesus. Give everything. Give your weakness. I don't care what they give it all to Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And stay with Christ and with thanksgiving, thanksgiving, thanksgiving. There's one woman, we read the testimony, who was blind for 4 years. She said, I'm going to get healed. Remember that testimony? She said, I'm going to get healed. I'm going to say every day. He spent about what? Was it 4 hours or 2 hours? Yeah, 2 hours every day just thanking God and telling God that he's going to get her healing. He's going to get her healing. After about 2-3 years now, the healing is 100% healed.
That's right. It will happen. That's right.
Brother, stay faithful. Stay. You see, you don't go to God and get something just 3 minutes.
That's right. Amen.
Stay in faith. Claim it. And stay faithful in the word of God. And thank him. Thank him. If somebody gives you something, you thank him, don't you? Jesus has given to you. It is in the spirit. Thank him for, Lord, I received the healing in my mortal body. And I thank you for the healing you purchased for me. That's how you take it from Jesus. I thank you for the healing you release from the cross, from your resurrection into my life. Lord, thank every morning you thank him for it. Don't worry no more. Just give him thanks every day.
Amen.
Right. Every day.
Amen.
Are you hearing me?
Yes.
If you don't have time to stay in the word of God and nourish your soul, you have time to die. Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, you have time to die. The death will come and you have to go along with him.
Mm-hmm.
But if you have time for Christ, Christ will come to you. Christ will heal you. Christ will deliver you. Christ will provide for you. Christ will sustain. Christ will do everything he died to release in your life. That's your inheritance now. So I'm going to ask you, what hour do we have? Is it 8 o'clock? Oh, I thought it was. So where did he go? All right, Brother Dwayne, come and put a song on there. How deep the Father's love for us. Okay, we shall stand, and when we finish singing, I just pray a simple prayer for you. But right now, your faith must be in high gear. I say right now, your faith must be in high gear. You've seen the truth. You've seen the word. Okay, you've seen the word. Jesus came on a mission, and I've shown you how the Father sent him. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, so that whosoever or believeth on him will not perish, but have. What's the meaning of have? Receive for yourself, possess, make it thy own. Okay. So let us all rise and sing How Deep the Father's Love.
How deep the Father's love for us. How vast beyond all measure. That he should give his only Son. To pray the church treasure. How great the pain of searing loss. The Father turns his face away. As wounds which mar the chosen one. Bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon his cross, my sin upon his shoulders. ashamed, I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. Oh, yes, God, my Lord. I will not boast in anything. No gifts, no power, no wisdom. But I will boast in Jesus Christ, His death and resurrection. Why should I gain from His reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart. His wounds have paid my ransom. Why should I gain from His reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart. His words have paid my ransom. Now, listen to me. All those who need healing, any part of your body, wherever it is that you need from God, now it is your turn to walk boldly and place your sickness in His wounds. Look at Christ on the cross. Look at Jesus Christ on the cross. Look at His wounds. They are gaping wounds. The blood is bleeding, it's coming out. I want you by faith to take your sickness and walk in the Spirit and go and place it in His wounds, on His body. Take your sickness and walk in the Spirit and go towards Him and put your sickness in the wounds. That's where they belong. It doesn't matter whether it's blindness, deafness, cancer, all kinds of, it doesn't matter. Take your cancer and go and place it in the wounds. Take your eyes, the eyesight, whatever it is, your physical body, pull them, walk and go there and put them in His wounds and walk back and sit down in the Spirit. Hallelujah. If you give it to Him, you don't have it. Don't go back with it in the Spirit. Literally put it there in the wounds. Go and give it to Him. Lord, You bore my sicknesses in Your own body. By Your stripes, I was healed.
Amen.
So I put my sickness in the stripes, and I receive Your healing.
Amen.
I put my sickness in Your... And in the name of Jesus,
amen.
You are commanded to go before the Lord. Walk in the Spirit by faith.
Amen.
Go to the Son of God. Behold the man upon His cross.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
My sin upon His shoulders.
Hallelujah.
Ashamed, I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. Go among the scoffers. Go to Him.
That's right.
and place your sickness, your disease, whatever it is, whatever part of your body, it doesn't matter. Put it in the wounds of Christ.
Amen.
And walk back in the spirit and take your seat. And I'm going to thank God for it. So I'm asking you in the name of Jesus. Take your sickness in your hands. You take it in your hands. And look at your Savior and your Lord on the cross. Look at him. The wounds are open. Fresh wounds. The blood is bleeding. It's coming out. And walk there and go and place it in the wounds. In the name of Jesus Christ.
That's right.
Do that in the name of Jesus. Say, Lord, you took my sickness in your own body when you hung on the tree. Today, I place my sickness in your wounds.
Amen.
Where they belong. And I don't have it anymore.
Amen.
And I thank you for the healing.
That's right.
Do that now.
That's right.
Amen. Let everyone do that now. Whoever you are, it doesn't matter. Just by an act of faith, we are acting it out in faith. Believing is an act of faith. See it. See that you are going and go and put it in his body. Broken body. And you go and sit down. Are we ready for me to pray? Have you gone there? Have you taken your sickness and
Amen.
Gone there?
Hallelujah.
See it in your eyes, mind, in the mind of your eyes. See it.
Mm-hmm.
Picture it yourself and go to Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
Put your wounds in his bruises. Put it there in the wounds. By the stripes.
Yes.
He bore on his body, on his back.
That's right.
He purchased your healing. So that's where your stripes belong. That's where your sicknesses belong, in his stripes. Now lift up your hands unto God. If you have done that, lift up your hands unto the Lord and believe it. Begin to thank him.
Thank you.
Begin to thank the
Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Yes, begin to thank the Lord.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
For his healing. That you took my sickness in your own body.
Thank
you. And now, Lord, I place my sickness in your wounds. That's where they belong. And I have received the healing.
Thank you.
I've received your healing. I've received, oh Lord, the healing in my own body. I have received the healing you purchased for me. In the name of Jesus, I receive your healing. I receive the healing you released for me. Father, I don't have the cancer anymore. I don't have this cancer. I don't have this disease. I don't have it anymore because, Lord, it is in your body. I placed it on your back. I placed it on your wounds.
Thank you.
Now, Heavenly Father.
Yes.
Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
We are standing in your presence.
That's right.
The very presence of Almighty God.
Yes.
The very presence of Jehovah. El Shaddai.
That's right.
Jehovah Tzidkenu.
Yes.
In your presence we stand. We have nowhere else to go. But in the presence of God is our dwelling place.
Amen.
So today, Lord, we've committed our sicknesses to you.
Amen.
We've placed our sicknesses in your wounds.
That's right.
We have placed, oh God, our torments, our frustrations,
mm-hmm.
our illnesses, our diseases.
Yes.
We place it all in your wounds today by faith in Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And Father, we claim the healing.
Yes, God.
We claim the healing Amen. From the cross. We claim the deliverance we need in the name of Jesus into our mortal bodies, into our minds, into our spirits, into our emotions, in our eyesight, in our nostrils, whatever in our mortal body, Father, the pain is no more in the name of Jesus. Thank you for your healing. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
The love of God is our portion. The healing love of God.
Yes,
the healing and merciful love of God now comes into our bodies. Now we receive into our being.
Yes.
Now we receive the blood of Jesus.
Yes.
In our being. Father, we thank you for the healing.
Amen.
That you have granted to us now.
Amen.
We thank you for the healing that you have given to your children. Father, it doesn't matter. There's no distance in the spirit.
Yes.
We are all together in your presence. We are the brethren from Michigan.
Yes.
We are the brethren in Michigan. And Father, we stand in Michigan. Lord, in your presence, all those online, you are part of the Michigan Assembly.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus Christ, our Father is healing us. Mm-hmm. Our Father is bestowing his healing virtue.
Yes, Lord.
Upon the sons of God in Michigan.
Yes.
In the name of Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Lord, I receive the healing.
Yes.
I receive the healing for your people.
Yes, Lord.
Let it descend upon your people.
Yes,
let
Lord.
It permeate their mortal bodies.
Amen.
Let it, Lord, destroy the cancers and the pain and the anguish in their mortal bodies.
Amen.
Oh God, let their eyesight be restored. In the name of Jesus. Let their physical strength be restored. In the name of Jesus. Heal them emotionally. Heal them physically. Heal them spiritually. Make them whole in the name of Jesus. And we give you praise. And we give you glory.
Amen.
For what you have wrought today.
Yes.
In Jesus' name. And everybody said, Amen. Amen. I give him praise. 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 Yes, God.
Hallelujah.
Now let me close with what I started with. The death and resurrection of Christ Jesus. Its implications for our life. When on his cross, the Lord of life, our Savior Jesus Christ, cried out, "It is finished." Tetelestai, it is finished. When he cried out, he was signifying, he was signaling the end of the reign, the regime, the rogue regime and rogue reign and rule over the spirit, soul and body of man. By the satanic and demonic triumvirate of sin, sickness, and death. That is what Christ was signifying. The end of sin in the soul of his children. The end of disease, sickness in the mortal bodies of his children. The end of death. Death will have no more power over them. Father, Christ has signified that a new power has been installed in the life of your people called eternal life.
That's right.
Yes.
Indestructible and invincible life.
That's right.
We
That came from your resurrection life.
Amen.
It belongs to your sons and daughters. And I thank you for the resurrection power. Now working mightily through the faith of your sons and daughters.
Hallelujah.
Father, heal them. And confirm your healing.
Amen.
With signs and wonders following.
That's right.
Your word.
Amen.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amina.
Amina.
Hallelujah.
Praise
him. Hallelujah.
Praise him.
Hallelujah.
Praise
him. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
He lives.
Hallelujah.
He lives.
Yes, God.
Father God, we thank you.
Yes.
As we prepared, Lord, to leave this place, we don't leave your presence.
That's right.
But your presence is our portion.
Yes.
The virtue of the Spirit of God inside us is carrying on the healing process. It's carrying on the work of God in our being. And we are being transformed. We are being made whole. Thank you for love, joy, peace that you release now into your children's being. Love, joy, peace from God the Father be poured into your being. This is your inheritance from being a child of God. If anybody online does not know Jesus Christ, I'm asking you to invite him to your heart. Say, Jesus, come into my life. Jesus, I give my life to you. Save me. Forgive my sin.
That's right.
Heal my sicknesses and diseases. And make me a child of God. I receive your forgiveness into my spirit. I receive your love in my being. I receive your peace into my mortal body. Jesus, I love you and I belong to you. Yes, you say that to Jesus, I tell you, he will make it quick work in your soul. Jesus died for you. And if you don't know him, just simply invite him to come into your life.
That's right.
And he will be there with you. Lord, I thank you. I commend your people, both online and, Lord, in the presence in the house. I commend each one of them to your loving kindness. I commend, oh God, their families, Lord, into your loving kindness, and may the blood of Jesus Christ continue to work in the lives of your family. We are your family in Michigan. Oh God, we are the family that God cares about. We thank you for healing us. We thank you, oh God, for making us whole, spirit, soul, and body. We thank you for your love, for your joy, and for your peace.
That's right.
Thank you, oh God, as you watch over us and as we prepare, oh God, to go away from this place. But we know that we don't leave your presence because your presence is with us forever.
That's right.
Forever and ever. So we thank you in the name of Jesus. And everybody said, Amina.
Amina.
Pastor, Phil's come on in here and come and bless.